All right, hi everybody. This is completely off script, off the rails. I don't do this at all, but we have found ourselves in a very particular situation with the JSU Football promotional video that just came out. It's been stirring up some stuff, a lot of traction on Twitter. I posted about it. So I'm just going to watch it again and then give some of my initial reactions. And then I'm going to go through as quickly as I can and just talk about why this was a terrible idea. I'm all for expressing oneself. I know art is subjective. And all that jazz, but I'm doing myself a disservice as someone who is in the master's program of a film school if I don't criticize something else that I didn't do. So, I don't know any credits. I don't know who directed this. I don't know who shot this. I don't know who edited this. I don't know who sound mixed this. And this, in general, is not in any way trying to demean the football players that are in the video, because they're football players. They're not actors. They're not stand-in people or anything like that. They're athletes. I'm not saying none of them have any acting talent. That might go back, if anything does seem off, it could go back to bad directing. So let's just give this a watch real quick. And yeah, so let's go ahead and hit play.
Get over here.
Alright, so I don't think that Adidas will be picking that up for their ad reel anytime soon, to say the least. Wow, there's a lot wrong with this. There's a lot wrong with this. So let's start it back up, and I'll pause and give my thoughts as we go on. So let's start at the beginning real quick. So my first initial thought, I was let's start there. I was put onto this by some friends in a group chat, and they were saying, oh, it's really weird, it's really bad. So obviously I had to go check it out. And initially when this first started up, I heard the choral music, I saw the suggestive shots of the athletes and the paint running down their bodies. Initially, I was intrigued. I like weird stuff. I like weird artsy things. So when we first started out with this, I was like, okay, I'm a little on board. But even with these opening shots, there are things that are wrong. Let me turn the volume down a little bit here so I can hear myself talk. Alright, so starting off, the shots are okay. The quality is bad, not because of the video, but because I just ripped it off of Twitter before the JSU Football Twitter takes it down. So let's keep moving. So right here, these two cuts are incredibly jarring to me. Let's just play this whole part right here. Boom. And then it cuts back and forth right there. I understand what they're trying to do here, but herein lies the problem. They're trying to do match cuts when the things don't necessarily match up. And it's moving in too fast. It's coming in and it's cutting way too fast. Edits like these usually need to go around very hyped up music, very like electric music, where things are always going to be moving at a constantly fast pace. We're listening to Catholic hymns, pretty much old choral religious music. So when you see a cut, let's move back a little bit. You see a cut like this, and then it goes bam, bam, and then it cuts bam, bam, and then it goes another one right there, and then smashes right that. You expect to hear big, loud, pumping bass, like really high energy stuff. Cutting to the beat of choral music is hard because, and I am no musical genius whatsoever, this is from the perspective of an editor, there's no beats to go off of to cut. Like when I was making the Southerners video for the end of the year highlight thing, the song that I was using had very distinct beats and drum beats to go off of, and you could very, very clearly see those spikes in the audio track, and so immediately I had a visual indication of when to cut. Cutting with the choral music just doesn't work at all. So let's go back to the cuts themselves. These are trying to be match cuts. That was the idea that they had going here. These are supposed to be match cuts. It works a little bit because you don't have a lot to go off of. You obviously have a full hand within the frame, but the angle changes drastically. And then if we can look at it, we see the lighting changes drastically too. And that's another point as well that we're going to come in, because of this gentleman's skin tone and the way that the lighting was set up, you have the frame before, not a lot of it is well lit. You can see that most of the light is definitely coming down from the right side of the shot, because you can see the light reflecting off of the white paint. But if you look at his thumb, his fingers, probably towards the back of his hand as well, it is not lit that much at all. Most of the light is hitting the paint. And then we go forward to this cut, and then the light is actually coming from the left side, maybe even center, more towards like very askew left of the camera. Because we can see the light kind of echoing off the stream right here. We can see the light coming right there. Kind of looks like it's off to the left right there. And we see a lot more of his thumb. You can also kind of indicate that it is coming from the left side, because you can see the shadow of his thumb is actually blocking this area right here of his index finger and a little bit of his middle finger. So we know the light is coming from a different direction, and plus his palm is turned outwards, and naturally, the palm of your hand is going to be a lighter color than the backside of your hand. So you have really big contrasting images. Because obviously, just by nature of color, red is a lot less prominent in brightness factor than you have with like a very bright white like this, even considering that the light is coming off of it. And then the lighting color of where the hand is, it makes it incredibly jarring. And they make it go way too quick to be match cuts. You can have the idea or the image of like really fast blinks. There are tons of athletic commercials that do that. But there's always usually a bit of just black, of just nothing. There's a few frames of just nothing that goes with that. And they don't necessarily do that, and it's kind of really, really shocking. So yeah, you can see the big lighting difference there. The light is very harshly pouring down to the upper part of the hand by where the white paint is dripping off of. The bottom of his hand isn't lit at all. We go to the next shot. You can see it coming from the left side. And the back of his palm is incredibly lit. And then you get this idea of they're wanting to highlight the body and the paint dripping. And then it, boom, cuts super, super close to just this very large profile of this athlete. And you can say the body kind of the mind kind of fills in where the camera's going. It's going upward, but you usually want a few shots of like it progressing up the body to like fill in the gaps. And this is just a huge domination of the frame. Like a giant domination of the frame. And you go from a very low profile. It is center frame, but you have a lot of dead on the left here, on the right here, and then it just smashes. And that's another thing that makes it jarring. I want you to pay attention to the length of this cut. That was so quick and so jarring and out of nowhere. So you have this gentleman taking up the frame, and then you're doing what the actually tries to do with a match cut of the paint dripping down. Now, immediately, we're like, whoa, where did this come from? And again, it goes back to lighting and just the color of the thing. Like, it just does not match up at all, especially with the framing of it as well. You see that probably if we drew a center line down the frame, the nose is kind of the main focal feature. It's where your eyes are drawn to most is the nose, if not the red in his hair. And then you start to see the paint drip down. But the problem here is that the theme so far has been the paint dripping. And we see that before the thing like even cuts to the next frame, there is barely enough paint going down this gentleman's shoulder. And also it's out of focus. So you go to the next cut, which is incredibly fast. You have a completely different focal point here. If you draw a center line down, it's going to be kind of like his upper chest. And that is the area that's in focus now. So your perception is already shifted. If you wanted to do like a true match cut there, you needed to have the exact same framing of that. And that's just incredibly jarring. Even the lighting is different as well. You have extremely prominent lighting on the shoulders. It almost looks like the light is coming from the top, because when he's looking down, you can see the light coming from the side of his hair. where the red is, but everything underneath, once it gets to the forehead and the face, is very shadowed. And you can see the shadow is only where his face is, pointed downwards. It's not at an angle. So the light is coming downward there. If we move forward, the shadows are completely different. Completely different. Majority of the light is coming from the right side now, with maybe even a fill or a backlight, which is coming around the shoulder right here. A lot of the light's coming around there, because you can see a little bulb right there on the side. This part of the paint on the what is the camera's right of his shoulder, it's very lit. Same with the shoulders, and you can see it's coming down this way because there is no shadow right underneath where the face is. You can see the line going right down the middle of his face where it's side lit there. You have that side shadow profile going on right there. And then around where his pecs are as well, where the pecs would dip in, you have that very dark area that is not lit as well. Harsh shadows coming around the camera left shoulder. You can see, so the light's definitely coming in there. So the lighting has completely changed. And that throws us off as well. And then if you're trying to convey the speed of motion going on here, you have the very slow movement of the paint right there. And then we move on to the next shot, and then he's just covered. He's covered in it. And it's not even on the correct side that we saw. So right there, it's just immensely, it's jarring. It's incredibly jarring. This is very, very jarring and jagged editing. And we're only 12 seconds in. Let's move a little bit forward here. Still really fast cuts, same thing. You have too much domination of the frame. You're trying to cut very quick, like it's an upbeat pop, rap, or electronic song, but you're doing it to a men's choir, and it just doesn't work. So let's keep on moving here. These shots, honestly, I really don't have a problem with these. These are just different profile shots. They're very blatantly stated as like, oh, we're just kind of moving around the body. Your typical artsy paint shots. Nothing much to say about that, honestly. This shot, I think, honestly, is decently composed. The only issue that I have is that you do have a lot of dead space around the right side of the frame, and you can see that his shoulder is getting cut off. You probably could have shifted him towards frame right a little bit more, because you do have your focal points aren't going to be around the top of the shoulder or the neckline. They're going to be right around here, right where like the shoulder meets the chest. But also just where the lighting is, your eyes almost kind of gravitate towards his center piece. His cross necklace. So he could have been shifted over a little bit more. Honestly, I think this shot's cool. I don't really have a complaint about this shot. No, I lied. I do. You can explicitly see the LED light right in the center of the shot on the paint. The paint is kind of betraying the shot here. The shot itself, I think, is pretty well composed. But the paint itself is being the betrayer. This one, alright, okay, this is where we have a lot of problems. I understand the direction I get. This is my interpretation moving forward from starting up until 24 seconds in. Was you have the paint dripping down their school colors, and they're almost mimicking this is why interpretation, keep in mind, they're mimicking the colors of like the uniform, right? You have the red and the white stripes going down the arm. You have majority of the red on the uniforms coming down the main chest of this gentleman right here. Then on kind of on the sides, you have like the white stripes. Same with on the sides as well, the shoulders. I don't have the football uniforms like down by memory. And then same with the majority of the red coming down the back. It seems like they're pouring the school colors, the uniform, onto the athletes. That makes sense. Then we cut to 24 seconds, and this is just an explicitly sexual shot. Like, this is... I don't think there is any way that you could not, in some instance, show this as sexual. By the candid nature tilt of his face is being tilted in, you have kind of like the sly opening of the mouth. It starts on the side of his cheek, of his lip, sorry, and is running down, and then it's just dripping off of his chin. What makes me angry is that the shot is okay, but contextually, it does not work at all. Like, at all. It makes no sense with the current theme that they're going into, and this doesn't scream, I'm pouring paint, the uniform, onto me. I'm engulfing myself in the school colors. It's just straight up sexual. I'm sorry. It is. This shot is like straight out of like a Victoria's Secret commercial, or like those very strangely seductive chocolate commercials, or lipstick. This is just a sexual shot. This shot's fine. If your main focal point is the paint running down, it's a bit out of focus. It could have been lit better. I really do hope the paint stains came out of the compression shorts or pants when he got done with the shot. This one is fine. This is also a you see, I don't know if you see shots like this a lot as well in other athletic commercials, but if you're having shots like these where the whole point is to run something down the body, the face, that part that you're running the paint down on has to be smooth. Like, if this was a good shot that they were trying to go for, the gentleman, more than likely, in a professional setting, would have shaved his legs so that there was no obstruction of the paint running down. There was no weird forms or globs that could come up. There was nothing, no hairs or anything that were popping out of the paint. You can tell because of like the weird bumps and bubbles around the top right here. You can see it kind of forming around this area right here where my mouse is. You can see it poking out down by the trail towards the bottom. If you're gonna try to perform a shot like that, your leg has to be shaved. Same with like the shoulders, the chest, especially around the face, if that's the kind of look you're going for. If you're trying to get this smooth running look and feel for it, it has to be smooth. The surface does. This is where the tone of the video initially starts to change, and my perceptions of everything were completely thrown out of the window. Because for the first 30 seconds, you have this very ominous, very weird religious and, dare I say, cult-like imagery. Very provocative, sexual in a way. And everything was lit black. Everything was just gone towards the back. Right? And then shot-wise, you have half black right here on frame right. And then, I don't know if this was intentional or not, but you can see the locker room start to come out. And that immediately breaks the immersion of whatever I was being immersed into. So and then here lies one of the biggest problems. This is also the start of the biggest problem of the video is the audio. Oh my goodness. Whoever mixed the sound, whoever sound mixed or worked on the audio and did like the musical selections and the musical mixing for this, didn't really know exactly what they were doing or what they were going for, I should say, more strictly. Because we had this really deep choral musical piece play throughout the background. Get over here. And then, okay, I'll get to that track in a second too. You have the creeping track come up where the bass immediately hits. I'm actually gonna put the volume back up to about 100 so I can actually hear the audio a little bit better when it comes in. So let's
get over here.
Okay. The build up, the transition from the choral piece to the modern piece was not long enough. You had a few of that lingering just bam 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 notes, right? And that was all we had before we got thrusted into the new part of the song. And you can almost hear the cutoff as well. The tapering, the fading, the dipping, whatever effect, audio effect this person used, wasn't mixed well. You can very hear, like, not clearly, but very faintly hear just where the audio just cuts off.
Get over here.
Eclipsed a little bit. They found a part where, like, the verse was resolving and already kind of dying down. The cut didn't seem super, super seamless unless you're really, really listening to it. But the problem with going from the choral piece to the modern piece is that it happens so suddenly. There is no major beat or musical indication to transfer us from one song to the other. And BPM wise, they might match up. I haven't checked at the BPMs for either of these songs, but rhythmically, it does not. And that bothers me a lot more than it should. Not even mentioning the Get Over Here track from Scorpion from Mortal Kombat. Whoever decided to put this soundbite in, the
Get Over Here,
is very much so stuck in 2012 or a long time ago that is not 2019. That is what we call a cringy moment. That was just pure cringe to me. That was just, I just didn't really see that as a professional use of a soundbite. And then we get into this gentleman ripping off his shirt. I believe this fellow has been running along with the joke of the video and just like joking along with it. So props to him for making light of the situation. But the problem here is that I feel like the shot lasts way too long. Way too long. Let's scroll back here a little bit. Let's count. So it starts at 35 seconds. That is a full 4 seconds. And 4 seconds doesn't really sound that long. But when you're doing quick cut edits like this, that is insanely long. That is an insanely long amount of time. The cut should have happened there, maybe even shorter. When the shirt is ripped and he is fully extended, that's when you could have cut. That should be a 1.5 to 2 second long cut. But we stay on this when his arms are in full wing mode. We stay on this way too long. This is an incredibly long shot. And you can almost see the aggression in his face start to die off. You can almost see the forcefulness start to come in. From when we started with the shot, you can see the aggressiveness, it starts to yell, and then you can kind of see you can tell he's forcing it by his eyes. So that should have been cut way earlier, probably about there. On that beat, you hear the beat right there? Boom. Like that bass right there, that very faint thing of bass, that should have been cut right about there around the 35 to 36 second mark. Let's go to this next shot. It's a fine shot. Nothing wrong with it at all. I think it's lit very well. I think it's in focus really well. Average tough man sport shot. Well, you have the big buff football player rubbing the paint underneath his eyes. The only issue is same thing as the last shot. I think it lingers a little bit too long. That shot ended about 39 seconds. The last one did, so we'll go back. You feel how it just drags on, much like this video that I'm doing. It happens, it's too long. Same with this one. I feel like right there, as soon as he opens his eye to the camera, it could have cut, but it stays way too long. That eye movement, you could tell he was looking at whoever was directing this to wonder when he was okay to cut. You see that eye shift, and it's almost like he was looking to figure out how long he needed to hold it for. As soon as he opens his eye, there. That's it. There's your shot. But it just lingers. This shot is fine. Typical run-of-the-mill. Just athletic tape coiling up. That's fine. Here is a huge audio problem. I don't know who recorded this track. I don't know who did the audio effects for this track, who mixed it. But when he says, "Are you ready?" you can't even distinguish what he's trying to say. And it's very evident as well that this audio track was not played out loud when this gentleman was recording this take, because it doesn't sync up at all. If the whole gimmick was him going to do this in slow motion, then whoever was running the audio on that track should have taken that audio track and then, like, manipulated it in a way to where when the video was slowed down, they should have taken the track, the Are You Ready track, and sped it up. So then that way, when they slowed the video down, it looked like he would have been talking in real-time speed, even though he was moving in slow motion. So that way, it would have matched up with the audio take. But I'm just in shock of how unintelligible this recording is. Like, it almost, he starts the U so much sooner, and it just feels, he starts it right there, and this is, you can just feel the gap between when he starts saying it and when the actual audio track comes in. That's like half a second. That's like a good beat. And those little moments matter when you're editing. That's just bad editing. That's just not good editing. And you can barely even hear. It's so bassy, there's not enough high end there. You need high end to kind of distinguish it. And the problem is, too, is that they made it really bassy, but they didn't mix the bass well enough to where you can feel the bass. It just feels dark and hollow and tinny and almost empty, to where there's no high end, so it doesn't really catch your attention and it's hard to understand. But the low end isn't full enough for you to, like, feel the impact of the line. That's just all around bad. I think that's just bad sound mixing there. This shot, typical, it's cool, it's fine. Your average product placement, you got Adidas just plastered right there. That's understandable. No complaints with this shot. Shot composition wise, it's fine. Don't know if this was a perfect choice as to why they're high. I think most of the light is going on the Adidas logo more so than it is our school logo and our conference logo. And I think that just is a confirmation that we serve our corporate overlords. And I feel like, too, a problem with a lot of the slow motion stuff, a lot of stuff needs to be happening to be in slow motion. Like, a lot of my video for the Southerners, there's a lot of slow-mo in there because it was banned. People are moving, people are doing things, the camera itself was moving, so it kind of invites the idea of slow motion, because banned is very action-packed, whether you like to think of that or not. People are moving, people are doing things constantly. Him just kind of buckling up, I don't really think need warrant slow motion, him gearing up for the game. I think the focal point in this shot is completely wrong. If the whole, blatantly, because we'll see it at the end, there's an Adidas tag at the end of the end of the video. This was also to help promote Adidas, to promote the brand. The foreground should have been out of focus, and the background with the very blatant Adidas logo should have been in focus. That should have been your focal point there. The focal point should have been reversed in this one, because if they're trying to put forth a product like they were in these previous shots, like having most of the light on the Adidas here, very blatant Adidas there, we're not interested in this gentleman tying his shoes. We're interested in seeing the shoe and seeing the big Adidas logo on it. So I think the focal point should have been reversed on here. And also to tying, and here's a tip as well to show. I want you to go back, whoever created this or anyone who's watching along at home, go watch montages and slow-mo stuff of people gearing up, of athletes gearing up, of superheroes gearing up. The shot that they show is always at the end of the action. So this gentleman should be finishing tying his shoe, and the shot should start when he's just tightening the bow of his laces and then removing his hands and standing up almost. That's where the shot should start. So, because again, we're thinking of this now because it went from a weird artsy piece to a hype video towards the middle, and now it's just an advertisement. It's an advertisement for Adidas. We have to think about that now. I want to see the shoe. I want to see the product you're trying to put forth to me. And if this gentleman's hand is in front of the shoe that's in focus, and the shoe towards the back that we can see more of is not in focus, then we're going to be drawn to look at the shoe in the foreground. And his hand is covering it up. We want to see him lacing up the shoe. I get that. I understand that shot. But it should be starting at the end of his motion. So let's see where the shot ends. Yeah, okay. We don't even see him finish tying his shoe. The shot should have started when he was done. He should have removed his hand. We see the nice, pretty bow on the shoe, his hand going up, and then we see the full shoe in frame. And that just doesn't happen. Moving on. Typical hype video shot, smoke, putting on the helmet, see the logo behind. So it's from a back profile. So it creates a more ominous feel. It's out of focus, but I can just see the veins popping out of the biceps of this gentleman, and it makes me wonder what I'm doing with my life. I feel the turn was unnecessary, because it didn't go anywhere. Nothing was revealed to my knowledge, except for the JSU logo on the helmet, but that really isn't our focal point there, I'll be honest, because when I was watching this shot, especially when he was turning, my attention was on his hands, because that's naturally the center frame, and that's the main thing that's moving. Like, everything of him is moving, obviously, but that's movement within movement. So that's where my focal point is. I'm following his hand. So if we track the kind of where my eyes move, that one, I start him coming down, my eyes follow the Rydell, and then I see him turning, then I follow his hands coming down. Nothing was there where his hand was. Nothing was being revealed. If what was trying to be revealed was the JSU logo on the helmet, then that should have been more center frame. We should have seen the helmet more in the general central area of the shot. So the shot was cool. It could have ended right there. Again, the setting becoming your worst enemy. You can see the LED light and the reflection there. So the light itself that is helping the shot is also the shot's worst enemy. I'm curious as to whether or not this was shot on a gimbal, on a roller, or per handheld. I'm trying to look for feet movements, feet bounce. It looks like a smooth gimbal shot at the beginning, but I'm seeing a very, very faint amount of jiggle. That could just be the jiggle from like the motors inside the gimbal. I know JSU has access to equipment like this. That's another thing too, be careful with your cuts. You start your cut right here where their foot is already in motion. And it's kind of dragging behind a little bit. Just a bit. They mashed it up pretty much as good as they could. Maybe one or two frames of just a little bit of weirdness. Overall, I'll backpedal on my statement there. That was a decent match cut. So you have the logos in frame, typical stuff, swinging in. I feel like the light is not where it needs to be. Because if we just look right here, most of the light is actually on our gentleman in the background, the third person in this line. Most of the light is hitting them. Whereas I feel like our main focus should be the person who is closest to the frame, but we see he is out of focus. Because we can clearly see this thumb right here, where like we see this gentleman's hand. And then this is just a very, 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 very big blatant breaking of what's known as the 180 rule. Not super complicated, but just to explain it here, to kind of explain what I'm going for here, we establish them walking from left to right. Okay. This is how we perceive their profile walking. This is where we put ourselves in the camera, where we perceive the motion to be going. All right, even though there's a blank frame, boom, we come from the completely opposite side, and it is incredibly jarring. And I know I keep using that word, jarring, but that's just how I felt throughout the entire thing. Just out of nowhere, jarring. So let me move here. And I don't know what it is about this shot. Everything else seemed fine, but I don't know if it was about the motion or whatever. It felt weird and awkward to me, just the motion of the camera. And then, boom, why can we see your light in frame? No, you should never, ever, 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 ever see your light in the shot. It is blatantly in the shot. So much in the shot that it actually becomes the focal point of the shot for a brief moment. Like, it's so incredibly high contrast compared to the rest of the shot. It's so overexposed that you can't help but notice it. I don't understand how this got passed the cutting room floor. That legit boggles my mind. Then we go to this shot, this turn. Like I said, the turn itself feels very bouncy, very wavy, not smooth. So I don't know if this was done on a gimbal or handheld. If it was done on a gimbal, was there a remote that someone was pressing manually and there wasn't a set path or anything? Because I know if you try to turn the gimbal, the turn should be relatively smooth. But yeah, see how bouncy it is? See how just... And then the problem is too here, and this just goes back with lighting. A buddy of mine mentioned this. These two gentlemen their face is extremely silhouetted. Very ominous, very dark, and I get the vibe. When we get to this person, why is he so incredibly lit? Why is his face so prominently lit? It doesn't match with the vibe that they're going for at all. like you have these deep dark profiles of these two other players right here, but then there's just way too much light on this person. It's jarring. There's that word again. And then also this shot started a little bit too late and ended too early. If that makes sense, if that makes any sense. Because we barely see the you ready. I want you to see how quickly before the Y and the R come into frame to when it cuts. Like, it was barely in there. That could have been stretched out a little bit. But that's the end of the video. And then I'm also not going to mention how the choral music comes back in. I actually am going to mention that because it makes me mad. Cut, and then you right there. That's a good place to cut it for the modern music track. But then I want you to hear how just suddenly the choral music comes back in, and there was no fade or dip off on that last track, so you kind of still hear the impact of like the next beat of that modern song. A fade could be a simple way to get rid of that. Maybe have a fade mixed with like some reverb, so you kind of have some echo tapering off. Actually, yeah, that would have been good. I feel like a safe way to do that is you have the end of the modern song reverb and echo off to kind of like ease into the choral piece, since it is very echoey and reverby, considering it was more than likely recorded in the church. So, and then it starts so jarring too, but yeah, overall, I wouldn't necessarily call this a train wreck, but there was too much going on. There were three different types of videos within one. You had your super artsy, weird piece right here. That I actually was on board for a little bit, and then it suddenly cut to the hype video with this gentleman tearing off his shirt, and then it got into the stereotypical like football hype video, and then it just turned into an ad. It just turned into an advertisement, and it didn't know where it was going. I don't know if there is any one singular person to put the blame on. I don't really know if we should be blaming anybody, more just criticizing with a level head, because this is film, this is art, and film art is a collaborative media. Someone had to set up all the shots, someone had to shoot it, someone had to do this, someone had to edit, someone had to sound mix. It's a collaborative thing. But it seemed like they had 20 different people with 20 different ideas and directions that they wanted to go for, and they didn't know what to do. I wouldn't necessarily call this embarrassing, confusing, a little bit cringy. I would say confusing and frustrating. That's where I'm going to leave it at. I think this is a very confusing and frustrating piece. Is the JSU Football Twitter going to take it down? I don't know. Are they going to embrace the joke now? Are they going to redo it? Are they just going to run with it? I don't know. But yeah, I'm done ranting. A lot was wrong with this video, and it could have been done a lot better. But I know some people are proud of it, and they put lots of heart effort into it. So congratulations for creating something. You put something out, and that is a lot more than other people can say. Because you have people who sit behind the mic and criticize like me, but that actually haven't made anything, haven't made short films, short videos, hype videos, highlight reels. I haven't made stuff like that, and they think they can do it better. So actual legitimate props and congratulations going out and making something. that's more than a lot of people who are complaining can say, but there needed to be a direction. There needed to be a direction where this was going, and a lot of smaller elements needed to be executed in a much finer way. I'm done ranting. So bye.